I got one. Just the new beginnings, the beautiful morning that we have. And I was just thinking as I was coming here, just the blessings of sobriety. Sober mind, you know.
Amen.
I sit back and look and go, why, you know, when you're in the world, man, I can't wait to get out of my mind, you know. And I'm thinking, what a blessing it is to have a sober mind, to take in this beauty that we have. And to live one life where you wanted to get out of your mind to where you're in Christ and you're living the best life that you can. You got all functions of your brain going and you can take in everything. And I just praise God for that love of wanting to be sober and continue to be sober and live for Him.
Amen.
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 I do have something. If you're here today and you wonder what a miracle looks like? There's one sitting right by
you. Amen. Yeah.
This church is full of miracles. I'm looking at another one sitting right here.
I mean,
I can go on and on. But if you're here and you say, I've never seen a miracle, what we're going to do, and I've just talked to her, we're going to get the picture of the truck, and we're going to put it in the frame. And we want you guys to see it. This truck was upside down, and it's flat. The truck is flat. And it's nothing but God. God grabbed a hold of her and put her where she needed to be inside that truck.
Amen. Right. Amen.
Because I'm telling you, once you see the truck, you say, oh my gosh, there's no way someone can live through that. But God's not done with it.
Amen.
So if you want to touch a miracle, before you leave, shake your hand. Because that is a miracle. Right, here's another one. They're everywhere.
Yeah. Amen.
I'll be quiet now, I promise that.
In our Sunday school, our verse was John 1, verse 4, and it says, the Word gave life to everything that was created, and His life brought light to everyone. Amen. I love that verse. That goes along with what Keith was saying. And so I told my Sunday school class, try to make a habit. Every morning you wake up, there's something you can be thankful for.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Mr. Kaysen, you're with us. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Can you bow yourself in a word of prayer?
Amen. Yes.
I love to talk to the Lord. Lord, we're coming before you today, lifting you up on high because you are so worthy.
Amen.
Lord, we cannot praise your name enough.
Yes.
God, because you're so worthy. Lord, I want us all to dwell on that. You deserve all the time we can put forth to praise your sweet, powerful name.
Yes.
Jesus, those among us, we have a lot of people here today, and that means there's a lot of problems here today.
Oh,
and God, you're the answer to each and every one. Some may say, well, she don't know what I'm going through. No, I don't, but God does.
Yes. Right.
I can't do anything about it. Anyway, but God can.
Yes.
Lord, I pray that you just sweep through this congregation, picking out answers as you go.
That's right. Thank you.
Jesus, come and be with us in this service. Yes. Lord, I want to praise you all through this service. God, I want you to come among us, dwell in our hearts, in our minds, in our souls, that when we leave this place, we can say, I have been in the Spirit of the Lord today.
Yes. Yes.
I praise you, Jesus. Come among us, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
We have a delightful thing,
right?
Miss Eve would like to sing a special, so we're going to start out with that.
So, the Lord had a song in my heart for 2 months now. I finally got the courage to actually ask me if I could sing it. I'm obviously still nervous. But this song is speaking to my heart mainly because of just remembering that people are going to hate you for being Christians. And no one likes to hear that, but they will. Mm-hmm. And knowing that they hate you, you know they hated the Lord. But the Lord loves us.
Yeah.
He loves us more than anyone possibly could. And because of that, he's always going to be our friend, even when we have nobody.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
So, I'm going to do my best for you. When I come home, I hope to have that letter. When I come home, I hope to have some air. When I come home, I hope to have that visitor. But when I reach her, there's no one there. But I got no friends today. And tomorrow will probably be the same. But I know no matter what I do, Jesus, I always have friends.
I had four 13-year-olds. I know how to handle you. Okay. All right, let me get set up here. All right. Okay. Let's see. Jesus forgives us of our sins. I want you guys to hold a penny up so everybody can see it. Can you guys see? That was pretty dirty,
yep.
Right?
Yeah.
I see.
Not very good at all. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. This represents us. So I want you to drop your pennies in there. There you go. Perfect. Let's switch your phone. Okay. So this represents Jesus. And when we ask Jesus to...
philosopher.
All right. So what I want you to tell you all is that when we ask Jesus to forgive us of our sin, who can tell me what he does? He takes our sins far, far away. So when we ask Jesus to forgive us of our sins, do you think we look the same as when we asked him?
Nope.
No. What would be some things that you guys deal with that would be considered sinful? Because I know kids sin. I have four of them. I know they do. Huh? Why?
Yep.
Okay. I'm going to ask. I didn't even have to ask. I'm putting mine up too, buddy. How many of you have been a liar? And every hand better go up because I know everybody here has been a liar at some point in time. What might be something else that you guys struggle with? That would be considered sinful. Somebody else other than Dimitri. What might be lying? What's something else we might do, guys?
What did you do to your brother and sister?
Go ahead.
What were you going to say?
Treating brothers and sisters that way.
Yeah, if we treat not only our brothers and sisters, but if we go to school or if we have cousins, we treat them bad. Yeah, that's not good.
Yes, sir.
Oh, did y'all hear that one?
No.
Say it as loud as you can.
Disobey.
Oh, damn. Dude, you hit it on the head. That's right. Can you guys think of anything else? Lying. Oh, I'm going to.
Wyatt's got one.
What do you have, Wyatt?
Disobeying God.
Yes. Disobedience with our parents. Definitely with God. Okay. Now. I want you to think about this one. I may not ask you to raise your hand, but I just want you to think about this one. How many of you have been at the grocery store? That line is forever. Yeah, and that candy or that gum, that sure looks good. Mom just told me no. I don't like to be told no, so I'm just going to kind of put it in my pocket. I'm not going to ask if anybody has ever done that, but... Absolutely, Gabby. That's stealing. You might think, it's just a little piece of making enough. Oh, Mama may not have seen, but Jesus saw. Right? Yes. So, I think we should check out to see if our sins have been forgiven. What do you think? Okay, I'll get them out and don't get here. This is kind of a hold this paper towel. Okay, we're going to lay these in there. Joey, can you read it?
Excuse me, young man.
He needs a microphone. I think he needs a microphone.
Just an ordinary church member here in the back. I can't hear you. Could you read out the letter?
That's fine. You don't have to use mic, but I'm going to ask you to stand up and project that. That would work.
You can do it, Lee.
Right here on this side. I love it.
Lee.
All right. Nice and loud. You got this, buddy.
No one's looking at you.
I raise a hallelujah.
our Lord and Savior.
Yes.
He went right there on one of those for me.
Yes.
For me. God so loved Rick Big Ears that he gave his only begotten son.
Yes.
Put your name. Don't take the world. I put your name in there.
Yes.
Because when he did it, was he died on that cross, each and every one of us, his name went through his head.
Come on.
One little drop of that blood was his. So we're going to do a little exercise this morning. Okay, I'm going to count to three. And I want each and every one of you, as loud as you can, to holler your name. Your name. You ready? One, two, three.
Yeah!
Man, didn't that sound awful?
Oh,
now, I'm going to count to three, and I want us all to say Jesus. Amen. As loud as you possibly can. You ready? One, two, three.
Jesus!
Oh, one more time. One, two, three.
Jesus!
Did you hear that? Perfect.
Another one.
One more time. One, two, three.
Jesus!
One, two. You're a rocket, sis.
Bless the Lord.
They do a queen song.
Thank you.
Yes, Lord, you're on the mind, you're on the mind. got the story of the prodigal son stuck in my head, and then I got to reminisce it a little bit. You know, that's something that us old people do. I know you young people don't reminisce a whole lot, but I remember when I was a little kid, my dad used to take me to the park. And, you know, when I was really little, he would be there for me, right? He would push me on the swings because I couldn't make the swing go. And he would be there. He would catch me when I would come down the bottom of the slide. And then and as I got a little older, we would go to the park together. And I'd be like, Dad, I got it. I can do this. I can do this. I can do that. And you know, my dad would just kind of go and sit down. And isn't that like us? Isn't that like us with God? When we first come to Christ, we're like, we need Him for everything. He's like, oh, catch me, Lord. Push me on the swing. You know, help me, Lord. And then as we go through life, we kind of drift a little bit. We're like, oh, you know, those old things set in. It's like, I can do it. You just go sit down and talk to the other parents, you know? Unless I get stuck, right? And then I would turn and I would look and see if my dad was still there, right? And that's the way we treat God. And here's the thing. If you're hurting or if you're stuck or if you're in a place where you need God, he didn't leave you. My dad never left me at the park, right. You know? I mean, he was still there. All I had to do was turn around and look for him or turn around and say, Dad, I need you. And he'd come running into the playground and pick me up or whatever. And that's what God wants. God's there. He didn't go anywhere. And in the story of the prodigal son, that's a picture of God. He was waiting. He was watching for his son to come home. Amen. And it doesn't say that when his son, when he saw him, he didn't just stand there and wait. No, he ran to him. He ran to him. God wants to run to you, but God's not, He's not going to force Himself upon you. So if you're in a place where you need Him, call out to Him, cry out to Him, turn around, just look for Him. He's there. He wants to help you. Don't sit there and be discouraged. Don't sit there and worry. Don't sit there and think, man, there's no way out. There is a way out. God is there for you.
Amen.
Amen.
And in the last couple years, they've had a very armored little boy. They bought a house, they're remodeling it, and they both own their own businesses, went through COVID. And this has just put a lot of strain on them. And I would just like to ask for us to pray for them.
Yeah. Amen.
They could come forward and we would pray
for them.
Absolutely. Amen.
Yes.
Believe we'll come to them.
Yeah.
Make it more comfortable. Father God, we stop for a moment here. I thank you, Lord, for Sister Allison's obedience. Lord, this is what church is all about.
Amen.
Lord, I don't want to move forward with our shouting and our celebrations if we have a brother or a sister that are in need. God, I just come to you. We come to you collectively as a church. We lift up Tyler and Taylor to you this morning. We lift up their marriage to you. We lift up their family to you. We lift up their businesses to you. God, I know how hard it is to be married. I know how hard it is to live with someone else. I know how hard it is to raise kids. And I know all these things come against us. And Lord, I know that it can wear us out. But I just pray this morning that you breathe a sigh of relief. You just blow a breath of relief in their marriage. Lord, I pray that you restore them to the joy of their marriage. Lord, I pray that their eyes would be open to one another in the same way they were when they first met. Lord, I pray that you would just build that connection between them. God, I pray that as much as the enemy's trying to divide, I pray that you would help them to just lock arms with one another and say, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen. Jesus, I pray that you'd set up camp right here in the middle of their marriage. Lord, I pray that you just go ahead and put a mailbox up and let them know that you're not going anywhere.
That's right.
You signed up for the long haul. When they said I do, you said I will too. And I thank you for that, Lord. And we're expecting miracles to come from this, Lord. I'm expecting
changes to come from this. I'm expecting their day to be different than what it started. Lord, I pray right now they feel your presence from their head to their toes. Lord, that they would feel you moving in this. Thank you for what you're doing. Lord, I pray for any other marriage that may be here this morning that needs a touch from you. That God, I know my own is not exempt from that. Lord, I know we all need you. Touch us from here. Help us to remember that we're on the same team and we're doing this together. Thank you for the gift of marriage. Lord, thank you for our spouses. Thank you for love that you give us. Thank you for this wonderful, wonderful service that we're in. Continue to have your way. Holy Spirit, run this service. That's what we've seen. We don't want our rest. We want to serve you. We pray this in Jesus' sweet name.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. That's right.
Follow the Spirit.
Oh, if you can't feel the Spirit of the Lord here today, after the ghost saying it is, your words are wet.
As you like I told Brother Mark, it was like the old camp meetings we used to have here at Frankfort. I mean, we'd have church camp all that week, but then the nights they had the big services and everything. I mean, and the movement of God moved all through that campus. I mean, people going by probably thought, look at that mob. Yep, it's a mob for Jesus. Because I'm telling you what, they went and they moved and they followed the Lord and they went with the people that needed help. It was just a mighty moving power, and that's the best way to have a service. Oh, let God have control. Amen.
Oh, I can't even walk without him holding my hand. I'm called number one. Would surely. What I wanted to be, I thought I would build.
Everybody.
Oh, flat sinking sand, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
Oh, listen to me now.
I had done a lot on my own. I thought I could make it, Brother Barry, all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man. Less than a man, because I
because I can't hear the world without you holding my hand.
All right, let's sing that one more time.
Lord, I can't.
Right.
We got two
of their babies.
Yes.
I'm
us doing our best to follow God's direction. God will come through for you. You pray for those babies. And listen, this little bitty girl right here, you need to start praying right now for his wife. Oh. Yes. Before my babies were born, I started praying for their spouse.
Yes.
Because that little person was being born somewhere else.
Right,
and I wanted that person to be raised up in church. If they're going to pair up with my kids.
Amen.
You know, God was so good to me. Every one of them married Christians. Now, a couple of them backslid. I'm not going into that. That's up between them and God.
Amen.
But as I was watching them, and Anthony too, big ol' Anthony, he's our baby boy. And I was looking at him. And I told Jan, I said, look at him, Jan. They're living. They're Christian
heritage. That's right. Yeah, that's right.
They're living their Christian heritage.
Woo!
Right? I could not do this. It took God.
Yes.
But if I didn't get them, where we come together to meet God,
yes,
they wouldn't know anything about this.
That's right.
Listen, people, I'm begging for your babies.
Yes.
Bring them faithful.
Yes.
Bring them faithful. Don't let them sit out of the house of the Lord because they get to be 12 years old and they don't want to go to church anymore. Too bad, too sad.
Yeah.
You don't let them stay home from school.
That's right.
Because they don't want to go, do you? No. This is more important.
Amen.
And I love education. This is more important.
Yes, it is.
Keep your babies in church. Let them learn all the little songs. Let them learn all the Bible stories.
Yes.
You know, David and Goliath. That's exciting when you're 6 years old. Please continue to bring your babies.
Yes.
It makes a church full of life.
Yes.
When there's young people in it.
Amen.
Well said.
Amen. Praise God.
God prepared me. He sent you away. Thank you.
time.
Bless him, Lord.
I've been the person in charge when any of my family has passed away. And I couldn't express my grief and sorrow for them. I just did it.
Help him, Lord.
And here's for my wife, here's for the Lord. And I'm so thankful for that. I've prayed and prayed and prayed for this. Thank you, Lord, for bringing it up. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
What we do now, church?
You got 5 minutes before we do more praise and worship.
I got 5 minutes. I don't have time.
You better order some pizza.
Wow.
You are only.
Yeah. Cool. Wow.
Hey. Not only an usher, I'm a gold plated. There's a little bit of backstory for that, but that's another day. Why don't you turn with me to John chapter 20? My brother, faith and sermon.
I be glad. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for you just showing us new ways of your operation as the church, Lord. We don't want religion, Lord. We just see it, but the Holy Spirit is in control. When we come to church and we gather, Lord, we can see that there's not one service that's the same, and we don't know what you're going to do, Lord. We just want to thank you, Father God, for that. We just pray, Lord, we lift up Brother Mark, Lord, we thank you for a man of God that is not afraid to speak your word, Lord. I know the burden that he has for his flock, Lord, or your flock. Mm-hmm. And Lord, we just pray right now you would settle a peace upon him and a presence of the Lord, that you would just speak right through him. Yes. Every thought, every word, Lord, would just come right from you, Lord. And we just pray this message, Father, would just come and you would meet us, Lord, in our hearts so we could take it in, Lord. It doesn't matter if it's a great message, but if we don't have anointed ears and anointed hearts to take it in, Lord, then it's worthless. So we pray, Father, for a life-changing message that will get us going in the direction of life that you've called us, because Jesus, you're the way. You're the truth and the life. And so, Father, we just pray that you would show us the way of where you want us to go in our life. We pray that your will be done in each and every one of our lives. And we just want to thank you for this awesome message that's coming in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved.
Amen.
That's a great verse. That is salvation.
Yeah.
Steph and I got in the habit for a long time. We were leaving tips at the restaurant, and I would write Romans 10:9 on there in hopes that someone would go look it up, because in that verse you can be saved.
Yes.
But I want to talk to you for just a little bit this morning. I have been on a roller coaster this morning trying to figure out what direction I was supposed to go, and I made a big old circle, and honestly, even when I asked Keith to pray, I still wasn't sure where I was going. But the Lord has an awesome way of using one single word in Keith's prayer to give me confirmation that I was on the right track.
Amen.
Thank you for following the Lord, brother, and thank you, Lord, for confirmation that you gave me.
Thank you, Jesus.
I was honestly hoping for a different direction. I would have loved to have followed one of the best praise services I believe we've had yet at the Fountain of Life.
Praise God.
With a great mountaintop uplifting, attaboy, let's go home. But I know how to do nothing except to follow the Lord.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Thank you, Lord. Simply, something's missing. The simplest way I can say everything I'm getting ready to say is something's missing. We have the easiest salvation that can ever be laid out for us. And it's way harder than it looks. I am fearful that preachers like myself have made it too easy. I'm fearful that we've concentrated on so much on how easy it is that we've looked past one of the biggest words in Romans 10:9, and it's believe. I want to talk to you for just a little bit this morning about belief. Because I believe I could go through this room, and if I could make you all honestly answer, I believe every person in this room would say, yes, I believe in Jesus Christ. I don't believe I would get a no. I think every one of you would say yes. Now, I'm going to follow that up with a very bold statement that you may not want to hear. I do not believe every person in this church is headed to heaven right now.
Amen.
I hope I'm wrong. I don't feel like God would give me this sermon if I was wrong. Where's the breakdown, right? I just read that if you believe in your heart, then you shall be saved, right? I read that. It's belief. So if you believe, are you saved? How can you believe and not be saved? Something's missing. Verse 24, but Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. Now, at this point of the gospel, Jesus has already went to the cross. Jesus died on the cross. Jesus was put in the tomb. And this is Resurrection Sunday. They're all gathered together and Jesus appears to them. But Thomas was not there. Then verse 25, the other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, praise God. They said, hey, we've seen the Lord. We've seen the Lord. Now he had been, these are his brothers that he'd been in the ministry with, that he had witnessed all these things with. And they knew, Keith, they saw him. It was as bold as Zach standing up and saying, I used to do meth, but then I met Jesus.
Amen.
Here's the problem. You can't run, listen to me now, you cannot run on someone else's belief.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. I think there's a problem we have that we think we can piggyback on mom's belief, or dad's belief, or my wife's belief, and everything's going to be okay. You can't piggyback on someone else's belief.
That's
here
right.
Comes Thomas, one of their brothers, that witnessed everything they witnessed, and they come up to him, and they had said they had to be excited. Jesus just rose from the dead. Hey! We saw him! He was here! And I would expect the brother to say, woo! He was there, and he doesn't.
Yeah.
Look what he says. They say, we've seen the Lord. Maybe the most powerful sentence in the Bible. We've seen the Lord. We've seen the Lord. And he says, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails. Listen to what he's saying. Put my finger into the print of the nails. He didn't stop with just saying, I got to see the scars.
Mm-hmm.
You show me the proof in the scars, I'll believe that he's a risen Savior. This brother says, I don't want to just see the scars, I want to put my finger in the scars. Mm. I don't want to just see the hole on his side where he was pierced, I want to stick my hand in the hole. Mm. He said, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails and put my finger into the print of the nails and thrust my hand to his side. Listen to this statement that a disciple made. I will not believe. Now, before I can move on from here, I got to stop for a second. We need to go back and look at what he did believe. Now, we don't know much about Thomas, but we do know he's one of the 12. So I have to believe in like manner there was a day that Thomas was going about his everyday life doing his normal thing and some guy named Jesus walked up and said, hey buddy, come with me. We know that he believed enough to sacrifice his old life. We know he believed enough to go with Jesus. We know he believed enough to say, sorry family, I'm moving on. I'm going with Christ. We know he believed enough to repent, right? He went away from his old life to turn away from something. Is that not repent?
Yes, right.
So this brother believed in Jesus enough to repent. Matthew 6:33 says, seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. He believed in Matthew 6:33 because his brother followed Christ. He believed enough to repent. He believed enough to follow, give him his life. He believed enough to follow Christ. He believed in Romans 12:1. He believed enough to present his body a living sacrifice to Christ.
Yes,
that's right.
He believed enough to be persecuted with Jesus. He believed enough to take communion. He believed enough to allow the Savior of the world to wash his feet. I don't know about you, but I think I just read out the best Christian that's ever walked the face of the earth. Right? He's got repentance down. He believed. He repented. He put God first. He's seeking God first. He left his family. He's following Jesus. He's presented his body a living sacrifice. Wherever you go, Jesus, I'm going with you. He partakes in the Lord's Supper with him. This guy is nailing it as a Christian. But listen to this. You may not want to hear this. This moment in time, this guy's not saved.
Come on now.
I just read to you about an unsaved person.
Yeah,
that's right.
Well, that's not popular, is it? I can tell that one did not sell well. Hey, do you want me to stand up and tickle your ears?
No.
Because I can.
No.
You want to go to church somewhere where they just say it's going to be okay? Go live however you want. I'm telling you right now, this guy was living for the Word. This guy was putting God first. This guy believed that Jesus was a person. He was probably baptized, maybe by Jesus, maybe by John, who knows what, but he was baptized. He repented. He was living out Romans 12:1, and this brother was headed to hell at this moment.
Come on. Yes.
That ought to scare you to
yes.
death.
Yes.
Come on. Amen.
Because it does me.
Something's missing.
Yeah.
I will not. If you want to believe in a fraction of Christ, you're going to get all of hell. When God revealed this to me yesterday, I was in awe. Jody scared me. It scared me enough to pray. I think, whoa! Hey, it doesn't mean anything that I'm a preacher. Did you understand that?
Come on now, Mark.
It doesn't mean anything that they stood up here and they sang.
That's right.
It doesn't mean anything that you're on our board or you're an elder or you're a deacon.
That's right.
Do you understand that as far as heaven and salvation is concerned, none of those things matter.
That's right.
God is not looking down at me and saying, yes, he's a preacher, he's in. I'm going to be real honest with you this morning. I don't have the resume that he did.
That's right.
Thomas had a resume now. I mean, as a pastor, you come to me and say, well, pastor, I've repented. I've turned from my old ways. I'm seeking God first in all that I do. I don't even have a job. I just am full-time ministry. I go around and I hit the streets and I preach the gospel to people I see. I'm presenting my body a living sacrifice to the Lord. I take part of communion as often as I can. You know what I'm going to say? Got another deacon. Yeah, this is maybe an associate pastor. This guy's got it going on. You understand that he was just as lost?
That's right.
Listen to this.
Come on.
As Judas?
Yes.
Come on.
He was headed to the same place as Judas?
Mm-hmm.
Why? See, we look at works, right? We say, well, Jesus told Judas it'd been better if he was never born. Man, aren't you glad he never said that to you?
Praise God.
We look at Judas and say, he turned his back on the Lord. He deserved hell. Hey, you want to know something? So did Thomas.
Yeah.
We look at it by works. If you believe in your heart.
Come on.
You say, I do believe. What kind of belief do you have? Unless I stick my finger in the hole in his hand, unless I shove my hand in his side, do you realize when Jesus said, Lazarus, come on, he was there? Thank you. You get up?
Yeah, you get up.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd a lot rather you just stop me and say, hey, let's get it going. Yeah. Listen, do you understand that he was there? Mm-hmm. When he said that, and Lazarus comes stumbling out of the tomb in his grave clothes, Thomas was there. I hear this story. If God would just show me, if God would just put a miracle right in front of my face, then I'd believe. No, you could not.
That's right.
He put them in front of your face. How many more do you need? You would not believe he watched a dead man 4 days dead walk out of the tomb. He heard Jesus say, you know what, destroy this temple. In 3 days, I'm going to raise it up. He knew the scriptures. He had communion. Jesus washed his feet. He watched blind Bartimaeus get his vision back. He's seen all of these things, and he says, I will not believe. What kind of miracle are you going to see that's bigger than that?
Come on. Sure.
This brother should have said, he was.
Right. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He was. He's risen. Listen, without the resurrection of Jesus, you got nothing.
Amen.
That's right.
That's why I can tell you very boldly, at this moment in time, this brother is not going to heaven. Because he did not believe in a resurrected Savior.
Come on.
Jesus was not some person that walked around. Jesus was not some good prophet that was here on the earth. Jesus is God.
Yes.
Jesus is God. Yes. Jesus was born of a virgin. Yes. Not enough to believe that. I believe in Christmas, preacher. Yeah, of course you do. You get presents. What kind of deal is that anyway? The Savior of the world comes down, is born of a virgin for us, and we give each other presents on his birthday.
Right. Doesn't make any sense.
I like it when church falls on Christmas. I'm going to cancel church. Hey, happy birthday, Jesus. We're not going to church because it's your birthday. It's not enough. It's not enough to believe he was just born of a virgin. Are you following me?
Yes.
It's not enough to believe that he was just born of a virgin. It's not enough to just believe that he had an earthly ministry. It's not enough to believe that he was just here 33 in a third years. It's not enough to believe that he was sacrificed on the cross. Without the whole package, you don't have it.
That's right.
I will not believe. Something's missing. You ever think that? You ever look around in a church service and go, how come I'm not feeling that? Something's missing. That word believe is huge. I would have thought anybody that's seen that many miracles, I've wrongfully said it, Paul. I've wrongfully prayed that prayer, Seth. Lord, show me something. Lord, if you just move something incredible, I would be so on fire for you. And he said, "Never come." No, we won't.
Come on.
I saved you.
Come on.
In a moment when you weren't even looking for it.
That's right.
I come down and I destroyed your old life. I grenaded that baby. And I took you out of that miry clay, and I cleaned you all up, and I set you down on a rock.
Amen.
What more of a miracle do you need to see?
Thank you, Lord.
Except for I put my finger in his hand. So
except for I put my hand in his side. I will not believe. Hey, you be careful if you're starting to judge your salvation on the works that you're doing.
That's right.
It doesn't have anything to do with it.
That's right.
Come on. Your salvation is all in belief. Yes, you have to believe he was born of a virgin. Yes, you have to believe that he had an earthly ministry. Yes, you have to believe that he went to the cross for you. Thomas had all three of those. You think, wouldn't that count for something?
Nope.
Maybe that gets him to heaven, but not in the gates, right? Maybe that's how it is. Maybe when he goes to this holding period, then he has a chance to say he's sorry. Then he'll have a chance to believe, hey, that's not biblical.
That's
Did
right.
I tell you that this morning?
That's right.
To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Amen.
The opportunity you have for salvation is here and now. Today is the day of salvation.
Yes.
There will be no period of holding. There will
That's
be
right.
no, Lord, I'm really sorry. Jesus said, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord.
Yes.
That's right.
That's terrifying, brother. Now, Jesus plainly said, not everyone that calls me Savior is coming into the heaven.
Yeah.
What? How about this one? Not everybody that stands and lifts their hands in praise and worship is going to heaven.
Yeah, that's right.
Not everyone that prays over a service is going to heaven. Not everyone that stands behind a pulpit and delivers a sermon is going to heaven. Not everyone that finds some beggar on the road and gives them money is going to heaven. Not everyone that drops money in the collection plate when it goes around is going to heaven. Not everyone that gets dunked underwater and baptized in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is going to heaven. Are you understanding this?
Yes.
This brother had that going on for him. He had church membership with the church. He had baptism. He had repentance. But he was lacking one thing. Something was missing.
Belief.
Yeah.
You see what he believed? He believed Jesus was maybe a prophet. But he believed he was flesh. And that's why he said that. You know why he said, I don't want to just see him? He wanted to make sure it wasn't the spirit of Jesus. You understand this?
Yep.
Yeah.
He believed enough to know that Jesus was going to go to heaven when he died. And he believed enough to even know that he may see the spirit of Jesus. That's why he said, until I know it's a person. Until I can run my finger in that hand and know that it's a hand. Because if it's a spirit, I'm not going to be able to do that.
That's right.
I will not believe. I have a question for you this morning. Do you believe?
Yes.
Yes.
Because if you're sitting there and you feel like something's missing in your Christian life, it's a good place to start.
Yes, yes.
Don't make the mistake that a lot of people do and think, well, I just need to do more works. If I get enough works going on, and then it'll be okay, right? I do enough for the Lord, and then it'll offset this feeling. Huh? No, something's missing. You know what it is? Jesus.
That's right.
He doesn't give you a third of the Holy Spirit, right? Yeah. Okay. Paul's repented. That's good. Here's a little bit. Paul, he's been baptized. Here's a little bit more of the Holy Spirit. All right. I'm going to hold the rest of the Holy Spirit until you believe in the resurrection. No, you know what it is? Ooh, he's getting close. He's getting close. He believes that Jesus actually was born of a virgin. He's getting close. Ooh, baptism's coming. He's getting close. You say, preacher, you can't get baptized unless you were saved. Or you're going to get saved because you're baptized. Listen, get off baptism.
That's right.
That's right.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
Salvation is not hinged to baptism.
That's right.
Yeah.
Salvation is through and only by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
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 That's right.
So yes, I believe I personally have baptized people that were not saved.
Yeah.
You know what I do if they come up and ask me again, Zach? I dunk them again.
That's right.
Yeah.
Something's missing.
simply even being that close. And it makes me wonder how many people have died this close. Mm. That's why Jesus said, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord.
That's right.
And it breaks my heart to think about the amount of people that made it to the feet of our Savior, Jesus Christ. They died and they were in the presence of the Lord and said, Lord! To see no smile on his face. Man, can you imagine that? Can you imagine taking your last breath, opening your eyes to a couple scarred ankles, to know that you're in the presence of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and to have that accepted, Lord! Wow, Lord! And to have him stare at you blankly?
Yes.
Say, I'm sorry. I never knew you. And that's when Jesus said, that's when they're going to rattle off the excuses. But Lord, Lord, I was a member of the Fountain of Life. But Lord, I led music. But Lord, I was a Sunday school teacher, Lord. Lord, I tithed 10% from the moment I became a Christian to the moment you pulled me out of here. Lord, I prophesied in your name. Lord, I cast out demons in your name. What?
That's right.
You ever stop and think about that verse? It's exactly right, Ty. I'm sorry. I never knew you. I ask you this morning. Come on, Chris. Where's your voice? Listen to what Jesus said. It says, after 8 days, again his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, peace be unto you. What do you think Thomas was feeling right about then? I don't think he believed yet. I think when he made the statement, until I stick my finger through his hand, I think he meant every word that he said. And Jesus said to Thomas, hey buddy, I sure not King James, but it works. I kind of feel like it went something like this. Jesus appears right in the middle, right? First thing he says is, Thomas. Oh, felt that. Can you imagine? Keith, can you imagine? This guy comes in and says, no. I don't believe that Jesus has the power to resurrect from the dead. That's what he said. And then to be in the midst, have Jesus appear, and the first thing he says is calls him out, and to Thomas, come on, buddy. Do it. Touch him. Stick it in there. Do you understand how much Jesus loves you? Find Jesus in this situation. Say, buddy, you go find Judas. That's where you belong. Doubt me after everything I've shown you. Not my Jesus. Jesus said, hey, it's great that you believe now that you've seen. And he said, blessed are those that believe without seeing.
Amen. That's right.
Stop looking for a miracle. Stop waiting for this lightning bolt. Stop making excuses. Are you saved? Don't you dare say, I hope so. Don't you dare sit there and think, I hope so. These words are written that you might know that you are saved.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
My finger is king. I felt his heart.
That's right.
If you haven't this morning, Paul. It's truly as simple as what I read.
Believe in your heart.
Yes.
Confess with your mouth.
Right. You will be saved.
Amen.
But you got to believe in the whole thing.
Yes.
It's true. You got to believe that it took the virgin birth. You got to believe that it took the earthly ministry. You got to believe that it took the work of the cross. And most of all, you have to believe that he rose on the third day. Where are you at this morning? As we stand.